Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Great pleasure to be here with you. Big thank you for the invitation to Stefan and Ian. I'm really impressed by the event, I must say. I was expecting a small symposium, maybe 40, 50 people, and what I see here is just impressive. Now, the technician will now talk to you, the apprentice will now talk to you about the solutions which we have developed over the last couple of years. Before I do that, I will do a very short recap of the trends Werner has already alluded to, kind of summary. And then I will talk about solutions which we developed to mitigate the impact of health-sensitive nutrients, meaning fat, sugar, salt. It's keeping us still very, very busy, and probably some of you guys as well. Then in the second part of the presentation, I will talk about sustainable nutrition. So the sustainability aspect, how to mitigate also the impact of our activities on the environment. Well, we heard already there are many socio-democratic changes currently happening. You have population growth. The globe is heading towards possibly 40 billion people, a huge amount of people on this planet. Urbanization is increasing, so many people living in the cities. Both of those two trends will lead then finally to malnourished people, deficient people, but also overnourished people. Then we have an aging population. In this context, of course, the personalized nutrition Werner was just talking about is getting more important. We have poverty versus rich, so the scissor is opening. We have super rich people, but also super poor people. And we have to serve, as the food industry, both of them. And then finally, we have the digital age. And this is coming like a tsunami, I must say. Even at home, I see that with my two girls. It's sometimes hard to keep the pace and to understand what they do in this digital world. And this is impacting, of course, heavily the food demand. You have food shortage, unbalance. You have challenges for the supply chain in these big mega cities like Shanghai, Mexico City. Personalized diet is getting quite popular. And then the affordability of products, we often forget. Finally, yes, nutrition is fine, but the consumer has also be able to afford it. Many of the people still have only $1 per day in the pocket to cover all their expenses. And last, not but least, changing shopper and consumer behavior. In China, already 30% of our sales are done via e-commerce. And that developed very quickly over the last couple of years. In the meantime, we have consumer trends which are indicating drivers of consumer choice, nutritional balance versus specific health benefits. Come in a minute to that. Natural, fresh, authentic, pure. People want to know from where the food is coming, how it is made. They don't trust if it's anonymously produced. Reduced ecological impact and fair trade also on the growth. Premiumization versus affordable products, it's of course linked also to the gap which is opening between the rich and the poor. And finally, information through digital and e-commerce. Today, the young consumer is searching information about products in the internet. They don't watch any longer TV. They don't go in supermarkets. And that's quite a change for the industry. Finally, supermarkets, they will show only the products while products are purchased via the internet. And of course, TV commercials, we see that in many countries, they have a decreasing relevance. Like I said, young consumers, they're watching YouTube, they go on Instagram, and they take the information from there and not from the TV any longer. Well, for many young consumers, health means not only nutritionally balanced, it means as well lactose-free, gluten-free, vegetarian, vegan, authentic. Authenticity is somehow linked for them with health, organic, environmental friendly, and also fair trade is somehow linked to that. However, it's important to take in mind, to keep in mind, like Werner said, that we have these different consumer types, but still, many of them, they're searching of combinations of those attributes. And typically, it starts with superior sensory and nutrition, so they expect a taste, if it is not well-tasting, it will not sell. In the meantime, they expect a nutritious product. Then, on top of that, they're looking for naturalness, authenticity, the pure thing, the real thing. The next level of the experience is, well, they are also now increasingly concerned about sustainability and creating shared value. And last not but least, and this is then the product, and last not but least, this is topped up with storytelling and an experience-enhancing environment. Coffee, for instance, one part of the experience to drink a coffee is that you smell coffee, that you see the barista preparing it. And of course, this is for us as an industry quite a difficult problem to crack. And we address that, for instance, by coffee shops. We build our own artisanal microbrewery coffee shops, which we are deploying worldwide. Well, now let me talk about health aspects of products. So what can we do to make our products more nutritious, more healthy? Well, on one hand, we can reduce health-sensitive ingredients. Salt on top of the list. Of course, we have as well sugar, which is increasingly getting under fire. And then we have, of course, the whole lipid aspect, the trans fatty acids, the saturated fatty acids, and finally, the total calories. We can increase as well the positive ingredients, whole grain, fibers, dairy products, fruit components. And then, of course, and this is very relevant for this community, we can look at gluten-free and lactose-free product extensions, line extensions. If you want to deliver then on top of that nutrition, specific health benefits, we can add bioactives, pro and prebiotics. The prebiotic is the food for the probiotic bacteria. We can enrich intrinsic nutrients. And finally, we can also modulate digestion in the gut. Werner talked about the microbiome. Has a much bigger impact than any of us here in the room probably will believe. Everybody of us is carrying around with himself between 1.5 and 3 kilograms of bacteria mass. So everybody of us is having in his own body more bacteria than human cells. And that, of course, tells you that these bacteria, they're quite important for our health status. Now, if we talk about health-sensitive ingredients, EFSA and the World Health Organization have published maximum daily intakes they recommend, and we in the food industry, of course, we have to try to comply with those. How do we do that? Well, there are three different strategies how you can do that. The easy one is to replace. So you take out sugar and you add sweeteners. But that, of course, is not the most efficient one. There's a much better solution. The better solution is we enhance the effect of the sugar quantity or the salt quantity in our products. We ensure that all the sugar, all the salt is reaching our taste buds. If you eat a chocolate, 70% of the sugar you just swallow without having an impact on sweetness. Now, if we can ensure that only 30% of the sugar is swallowed and the other 70% are reaching the taste buds, we need to add much less sugar without adding artificial sweeteners. So a very natural way. And finally, we can modulate the absorption of those nutrients into our blood, now to our plasma. Also a very efficient way, a bit difficult to communicate to consumers, I must admit, but an efficient way to mitigate the impact of those nutrients. Now, if you look at salt, let me first talk about salt, then I will come to the fat part and also talk a bit about sugar. Now, salt, in many food products, we are adding salt so much that we reach the saturation level of our human taste sensor. So we can reduce salt without reducing saltiness. So in some of the products, this is working very well. Then we can replace salt by potassium chloride. Potassium, anyhow, many people are deficient in potassium. However, it sounds a bit chemical, right? And hence, it's sometimes rejected by consumers. Now I come to the more efficient way to reduce salt. We can redistribute the salt in the product. For instance, if you have a pasta, and if you add the salt at the end of the cooking, you have it rather at the surface and not distributed in the pasta. And the surface is the part of the pasta which is acting with the taste buds, right? You can add it rather the salt in the sauce than in the pasta. So a very simple way to increase the impact of the salt in the product. We can accelerate the in-mouth release of the salt. I will show you in a minute a hollow salt particle, which is dissolving very, very fast. Meaning if you dissolve very fast, much of the salt is reaching really the taste buds. Then we can enhance the transport of the salt from the product to the taste sensors, so that all the salt is reaching really the taste buds. And finally, we can even work with sodium enhancers. Sodium glutamate is one, ribonucleotide are others. Come in a minute as well to that. So this is, for instance, a hollow sphere built out of salt particles that can be produced, for instance, by co-spray drying. So you take the salt, you add some hydrocolloids, some starches, you do a spray drying, you get this really hollow particle. On one hand, if we reduce salt in our products, we have the problem that we have to have still a certain product volume. If you take, for instance, a bouillon cube, you reduce the salt, nothing is left more or less. You have flavor, some vegetables, so you have to replace the volume. And this is one way to do that. On the other hand, it's dissolving very, very fast due to the high surface area. So a very smart way. By the way, this can be done with sugar as well. We can build those particles as well out of sugar. Now, what about the sodium enhancers? So soon here, the helicopter is landing probably on the tent. So what about the sodium enhancers? Well, how do we perceive salt? It's important to understand that. Well, in our cells, we have channel proteins. And the sodium ions, they're flowing through those membrane channels. While they are flowing through those membrane channels, they create a signal to the brain. And the intensity of this signal, we can enhance by using certain ingredients, certain molecules, like, for instance, ribonucleotide, which is a piece or an element of our ribonucleotide acid, our DNA, if you want. So that's one way. And now we develop sensors allowing us to screen for those molecules, which are naturally occurring in food products. And we would then just enrich them. And if we enrich them, of course, we get a higher salt perception of the product. Now, talking a bit about fat, and this is an evergreen. This is from Erich Winter and his team here at the ETH. I love to show that, because sometimes the solution is so simple. It was not so simple to develop the technology, right, Eric? But on the other hand, it's a very simple idea. So if you have ice cream, what's the problem with ice cream? Well, it's calories, it's fat. How can we reduce that? The team at the ETH around Erich developed a technology to extrude the ice cream. So if you pass ice cream through an extruder, high shearing, you decrease the size of the fat particles, the air bubbles, and the water crystals. If you do that, you get more creaminess. Smaller particles, more creaminess. Sounds familiar also from the chocolate domain. Now, that allowed really to reduce the fat content by 50% and still increasing creaminess. So to our consumers, we told, you get a much better product, much more creamy, and by the way, 50% less fat, 30% less calories. Fantastic story, 70% of our ice cream volume is produced today according to this technology. Chocolate, of course, chocolate is also very energy dense. You have a lot of fat, a lot of sugar. Even dark chocolate is having quite high energy density due to the cocoa butter you find there. And of course, the sugar. So what can be done in chocolate? For instance, we can do here microaeration, aeration in general. If we do that, we replace part of the fat via air bubbles, which are also contributing to creaminess, specifically if they're very small. And of course, the size of the air bubbles depends on the gas we use and the expansion conditions we apply. Mayonnaise, 90% fat. How to get a decent mayonnaise? Well, you can add some starch, that can be done, but then you get this gluey, sticky texture. And a low-fat mayonnaise is never as pleasant as a real high-fat product, right? So we developed here also, again, together with the ETH, a very smart technology. Mayonnaise, these are oil droplets in a water phase. So what happens if you charge the oil droplets again with water? So you have oil droplets surrounded by water, and inside the oil droplets, you push small water droplets. Well, you get quite low fat content in oil, and the body is still perceiving the full fat flavor because you cannot see, our sensors on the tongue cannot see the inner water phase. Then we enrich those inner water droplets via salts. And hence, we had an osmotic gradient. So some of the water is then flowing in those oil droplets, which are then ripening, which are blowing up like balloons. So we get the whoosh volume, you get a ripening mayonnaise, like a Bordeaux. It will ripen a bit faster. So you wait a couple of days, and then you have a very thick, creamy product. At production, very thin. You fill it in your jars, and then you wait a bit time, and then you get a very thick, creamy product. This we applied for dressings, for instance. Mayonnaise is still an issue because of shelf life. You have a quite unstable product. If you have a chilled mayonnaise, it's working very well. But if you expect 9 to 12 months shelf life, it's still a challenge to overcome here. And you see on the right-hand side this multiple emulsion-based mayonnaise structure. Well, we can also mimic fat droplets by protein aggregates. Technology which we developed here is that we apply certain pH conditions. We shift the proteins to the isoelectric point. That's a pH, an acidity in the system where the proteins aggregate and build small microparticles. And those microparticles, they are perceived like fat droplets. Very efficient technology, currently in the rollout phase for many of our categories. Well, and then I talk to you, well, we can also modulate the absorption of those nutrients into the bloodstream. If you have an oil droplet and you coat it with something which is keeping the oil digesting, fat digesting enzymes away, well, it cannot be digested. And then it's, of course, again excreted. You have the full pleasure in mouse, but no absorption of those calories. And you can do that, for instance, here with galactolipids. There's a product here from DSM called Fabulous, where you coat oil droplets with those galactolipids. And like you can see on the right-hand side, if you increase now the dose of this galactolipid, you decrease the energy uptake into the body. I developed once even a mayonnaise with an indigestible fat. It was a mayonnaise with negative calories when I started in the company. And it was not a success because finally the consumer was not believing when we said, yeah, look, the more you eat from this mayonnaise, the slimmer you get. it was a no-go. Well, and now let's talk after salt and fat, let's talk about sugar. Well, sugar, we can replace sugar via, for instance, with sweeteners, natural sweeteners like stevia. But we can also, if you look at the carbohydrates, modulate their digestion. And that's very efficient. If you look, for instance, at starch, and starch, if it is digested, is, of course, delivering sugar, we can play a bit with the digestion kinetics of the starch. And we can influence it via the crystallinity of the starch. Crystalline starch is very hard to digest. If you have amorphous starch, it's very easy to digest. So you have different starch types. You see here, for instance, on the right-hand side, some of them. Crystallinity is linked, on one hand, to the origin of the plant, the origin of the starch, but it's also linked to the processing conditions. If I have a crystalline starch, a potato starch, and I eat raw potato starch, it's hardly digestible. However, if I cook it, we all know, it's getting nicely digestible, and you decrease the crystallinity, and eventually the body can really take this starch up. On top of that, it's not only a question of uptake of calories. It's also impacting heavily our microbiome. If I have an easy digestible starch, of course, there will be not much starch left, for instance, towards the end of digestion. Yeah, in the intestinal systems, certain microbacteria will grow and others will decrease. So we can impact the microbiome, for instance, via the type of starch we will ingest. And digestibility of the starch has a huge impact also on our mental capabilities. We explored it here, for instance, for cereals. You see on the left-hand side, you see the glycemic response, like Werner said, so the blood glucose level after intake of different starch. You see here, if you take a maltodextrin, you get a high peak after a short time, so the blood sugar is increasing. If you take a waxy maize starch or corn starch, which has a high degree of slowly digestible starches, you get a much smaller glycemic response. Hence, the risk to get diabetes and to get obese is, of course, reduced. these slowly digestible starches, they deliver over a longer period energy to the brain. And you can see that here. This is, for instance, the number of the right answers children at school gave to a certain questionnaire as a function of time for two diets. So the children here, in this case, they were fed with two types of starches, one group with easy digestible starch, one with less easy digestible or slowly digestible starch. And you can see that the group, this is the blue one with the slowly digestible starch, was recalling more answers after a certain time. So the brain activity, the brain capability was increased if the digestion is delayed. And we all know that. If we have a heavy breakfast in the morning and it's easy digestible, a lot of sugar, towards lunchtime, we get a bit unconcentrated. We are waiting for lunch, huh? And then we have a huge, heavy lunch, and then we are getting even more sleepy. So it's much better to eat in the morning something which is a bit harder to digest, like, for instance, oat cereals, oat flakes, very hard to digest. And then you get the whole morning energy, and you don't feel that hungry at lunch. You have a decent lunch, and you're again ready to work after lunch, and you're not dead for the siesta. Well, in many of our products, we want to increase whole grain and bran content. One way is, of course, we have here an extruder, and you all know that, probably many of you know that. We can adjust the extrusion conditions, and we can, nowadays, produce decent cereals out of whole grain. But for some of our products, whole grain, addition of whole grain is getting very difficult. And I show here a recent launch, a recent development. We just launched end of last year. Fantastic development. We call that liquid whole grain. So we had the idea, we have a ready-to-drink product. It's a malted beverage called Milo, very popular in Southeast Asia, or Asia in general, and also some parts of the Americas. And what we wanted to add here is whole grain. For instance, wheat, oat, brown rice, barley, and not refined sugars. So we wanted to really have full whole grain in there. If you do that, you get a high viscosity of the product. And it's getting very slimy, and you cannot drink it. It's like a pudding. So our researchers developed the technology to hydrolyze the starch, to hydrolyze the proteins, the gluten, for instance, but to keep the fibers, the arabinoxylan on the glucans, intact. So the fibers are not touched, but the other stuff is more or less degraded, enzymatically degraded. If you do that, you see that you can keep the viscosity very low. This is the blue curve here. The green curve is our hypoallergenic infant formulas. For the native whole grain, the viscosity would not even be on this chart. So you control the viscosity. The question is that still as healthy as whole grain? Good question. We checked that as well via a biomarker called alkylresorcinol, which you find in the plasma. And you see here, taking in native whole grain, which is the orange curve, compared to this liquid whole grain, is the same response in the blood. So we can assume, really, we have here the full health benefit of whole grain, and we have a drinkable form of whole grain, a liquefied whole grain. Well, before I talk about sustainability, a quick breakout also in terms of natural food. Consumers are expecting more natural food. There's one technology which, in my mind, delivers excellent product quality, which is high pressure. However, you have to be aware where you apply it. It's not beneficial for all categories. For instance, if you take guacamole, if you take some of our shelf-stable gravies, in gravies you have starch, and the starch should gel only if you heat it. Now, how do you sterilize this product before giving it to the consumer? Not so easy. So we apply the high pressure. The starch stays native. We can sell the product to our customers. They dissolve it, and then the starch is transformed. This is our minor products range, which you see on the right-hand side. Then you find oysters, which are pasteurized here with high pressure, and you find fantastic fruit juices, for instance, at Tesco in the UK, with different apple varieties, where you can really distinguish between a Granny Smith juice and a Pink Lady or Boskop juice. Well, and now the remaining couple of minutes, I'm talking just about sustainable nutrition. Well, we have all quite some serious challenges to supply the world population with food, which are linked to the environment. You have climate changes, aridification, and you have pollution. And they impact, of course, agricultural production, but agricultural production itself has also an impact on those climate changes. You have, for instance, CO2 and methane emissions from ruminants, from cows, if you want, from rice cultivation, and then you have the water usage for meat production, which is huge. I will show you in a minute. Now, how do we address now environmental problems? Probably you have heard, if you look at the total value chain of a food product, the major impact is at the beginning in the agricultural sector and at the end towards the usage at the consumer. So at the beginning, we have, for instance, major sourcing programs for coffee and cocoa, which you see here, where we supply farmers with plantlets which are tolerant towards drought, so they can live with very low water. They deliver very high yields, and they don't need pesticides. We distribute those plantlets, and we educate farmers how to cultivate those crops. We do the same for cocoa. Towards the end of usage, we have two major problems. One is food waste. 30% of the food is still wasted in big cities like London. So consumers buy the food, they don't open it, they just throw it in the bin. 30%. Keep that in mind. If we would recover those 30%, probably we wouldn't have any starvation any longer on the globe. And then the second one is, of course, packaging. And this is very high in consumer minds. Packaging is not an easy one. Well, you can make packaging thinner. And many consumers want biodegradable packaging. But if you do the life cycle assessment of those biodegradable packaging, well, it doesn't look very good. Because you need a lot of energy to produce those materials, for instance, polylactic acid, polyethylene. And on the other hand, they don't protect the product that well. So you have a higher amount of spoiled product. So this food waste is even going up. But I would like to talk about the middle part of the value chain where we design products. Raising prosperity on the globe is also driving here the demand for meat. You have India, China today. Meat consumption is still very low, but it's growing. The aspiration is coming with the wealth of the people. If the people get more wealthy, they want to consume meat and dairy. And here a slide from Andreas Baumann from Bühler on the left-hand side. The problem is with those animal proteins that a lot of the protein, which is the major issue to supply the population with proteins, energy is, we can master, is that a lot of this protein is actually wasted due to animal conversation. If you have 500 million tons of plant protein, which is produced annually, globally, then only 200 of those are reaching the consumer. Why? Because a part we feed to animals, and animals have a certain conversion rate. So they cannot, if they take 1 kilogram of protein in, it's not 1 kilogram of protein out. It's much less. And then you have some waste losses. If you took, for instance, 100 grams of plant feed, then they deliver only 10 kilograms of beef meat. For the other animals, it's a bit better. On top of that, per cubic meter of water, the productivity of beef is very low. If I spend 1 cubic meter of water, I can produce only 100 grams of beef meat out of this. So I need for 1 kilogram of beef, minced meat, burger, meat, whatever, I need 16,000 liters of water. Huge. Plant proteins, better solution, much better solution. You don't have this animal conversion. It's much more affordable. You see here the cost per kilogram of raw material. The green ones are the plant sources. The right ones are the animal sources. You see it's also more affordable for the people. And hence, we developed in the food industry quite a range of different plant-based products. Some of us here, Tival is, for instance, our own. Osem here on the right-hand side is our own products. And then you have here also some products you find on the market, which have already quite good textures. It's never the same like a steak. But they're getting to a range, I would say, where it's a pleasure to eat at least some of them. Well, and then we have alternative protein sources which are on the rise, where we have even higher yields, where we have more favorable nutritional profile. We have, for instance, crops. This is here again a slide here from Bühler. We have aquatic biomasses, algae, single-cell proteins, insects, waste, and we have also in vitro proteins. And this is a projection here from the Bühler company where they assume how this market will further grow. Now, let me come to my conclusions, the last slide. Well, there are quite some challenges ahead to really supply the globe with tasty but also nutritious food, which consumers can afford and which are not damaging the environment. On one hand, we still need further creative solutions to reduce salt, sugar, and fat. It sounds very boring, but scientifically it can be very challenging. Just remember the salt enhancers, transport of salt to the sensors. That's exciting, scientifically exciting stuff. And there are still things to crack. It's not just that we work with replacers. That's the boring thing and the easy thing. But the more efficient, the more effectful thing is to ensure that the nutrients we have in the products are really having the maximum impact. Then texture-wise, acceptable gluten products and of course also lactose-free products. Pasta, we have already quite some good, and some in the room are producing those products, very good advances. Pizza, if I look at our own gluten-free pizza, they're not bad, but they're not a real pizza from the dough. So there is still some things to be done. Then the authenticity, to deliver authentic, fresh, natural, pure food, and which is manufactured in a transparent way, is for the big food companies quite a challenge. How do you give transparency to consumers? And you can do that by, for instance, shops, coffee shops, outlets, where you tell a bit the story how you produce those products, but it will remain on our plate for the next couple of years. Environmental footprint of biodegradable packaging, this is really something to crack on, because consumers want it, but we are reluctant to give it to consumers because it's even more damaging the environment in many cases. So we don't want to do that, but consumers are asking for it, and that remains quite a stretch. And last not but least, to cover the protein requirements, at least partially through plant or alternative proteins. Insects, of course, in many parts of the world, they're rejected from a cultural point of view. This is a spoiled product where you find insects in. In other parts, it's just normal to eat insects. Southeast Asia is a part of the diet. Here in the developed world, probably it will take still a bit some years to get the acceptability and to crack, of course, also the regulatory and safety aspects. And then you have, of course, the algae, where it's just a matter of cost. Today, it's very costly to produce those type of raw materials. Yeah, that takes me to the end of my presentation. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, and wish you a successful continuation of the conference.